Okay, well, thanks everyone for coming. And thanks to Petar for the invitation to do these three seminars. As he said, I've been coming here a long time, but actually this is the first time that I've really had an opportunity to kind of develop a line of my own thinking at greater length. Usually I'm in the position of a kind of conference organizer, so it's nice to have this opportunity. And so as Petar mentioned, this work is from a book project that actually now I've been working on for some time, on the relationship between rationalism and empiricism in contemporary philosophy, but then also going back and sort of reconstructing a larger tradition of what I call rationalist empiricism in the history of philosophy. And it is fitting, I suppose, that that my lectures here sort of correspond with this launch of the translation of After Finitude into Croatian, because certainly my way of thinking about, as I'll say today, my way of thinking about the relation between rationalism and empiricism was kind of inspired or provoked by that book. So these lectures are not really just lectures about Quentin Meillassoux, however. They're the first lecture is on the relation between Althusser and Meillassoux. And the second lecture tomorrow will just be on the relation between Althusser and the group Théorie Communiste, who have been writing based in Marseille since the 1970s. So that will be more a paper on political theory. And then on Wednesday, a paper on epistemology and ontology in Hegel and Meillassoux. So at that point, we'll come back to Meillassoux, but via Hegel's logic. And so what I hope to do is sort of, you know, as it says, sort of construct a theory of the way in which rationalist empiricism, which I'll explain as a methodology, relates to politics, epistemology, and ontology. So sort of major fields in modern and contemporary philosophy. And I should say something, I guess, about these handouts. So I've given you all these handouts. You don't really need these for the talk today. I'll maybe refer to the first one, but I've developed all this material and teaching some of this work, and particularly on Meillassoux's After Finitude, so I thought that we could distribute it just along with the talks. So don't worry about following those along through the paper, because most of those are not in the paper. But there's one handout with sort of basic concepts and positions in After Finitude, and there are some other handouts sort of mapping out structures of argumentation in the book. And maybe I'll refer to the one on the top with the arrow lines at one point in this paper. Okay, so let me begin, and thanks everyone again for coming. So the paper today, it's called Rationalist Empiricism, Dialectical Materialism, from Althusser to Meillassoux. So Louis Althusser, following Kant, referred to philosophy as the Kampfplatz, or the battlefield of contending positions. Yet, the field of activity produced by philosophical labor is, in my opinion, more like a labyrinth, wherein trapdoors open upon fathomless depths, and mirrored staircases produce inversions of ground, as in a print by Escher. The overcoming of previous systems is more often a matter of delicate construction than of direct confrontation. A philosopher builds a system not so much upon the ruins of a preceding one, as in the secret passageways among its corridors, working within its unexplored interstices until a new route opens through the labor of its incipient articulation, unfolding into previously impassable expanses. Always unforeseen, a significant development in the history of philosophy is more like a jailbreak than a prison riot, a fly escaping the fly bottle upon a previously untried tangent, a laborious and solitary sojourn in the dark toward the mouth of a winding cave rather than a smashing of idols. Althusser's image of the Kampfplatz, or battlefield, was suggested by a double opposition that he saw structuring the field of philosophical activity, setting its contenders against one another across antagonisms between idealism and materialism on the one hand, and between rationalism and empiricism on the other. But Althusser also spoke, on one occasion, of a synthetic tradition that he termed rationalist empiricism, And it's his brief invocation of this alternate tradition to which I turn in this book project, attempting to expand upon and substantiate Althusser's suggestion. So my argument is that a methodological synthesis of rationalism and empiricism is the key to distinguishing materialism from idealism, and to sustaining a materialist orientation in philosophy. Right? So the one holds apart materialism and idealism by synthesizing rationalism and empiricism. At the crux of this argument, and of the recessed tradition that it reconstructs, is the epistemological work of Gaston Bachelard, who was so pivotal for Althusser. Bachelard's epistemological writings are typically associated with a stringently rationalist orientation, dedicated in particular to extolling the centrality of mathematical formalization in 20th century science. And this is true, Bachelard certainly is a rationalist, but as his anti-Cartesian commitment suggests, he speaks at one point of an anti-Cartesian epistemology. So as that suggests, this is only half the story. Bachelard published a book called Le Materialisme Rationnel, so Rationalist Materialism, but in La Philosophie du Non, he also insisted that empiricism and rationalism in scientific thought are bound together by a strange bond, as strong as the bond which joins pleasure and pain. So this is a key formulation for me. The bond between rationalism and empiricism is a strange bond as strong as that between pleasure and pain. So it's not only rationalism, but rather this strange bond between rationalism and empiricism that is at the heart of Bachelard's materialism. Drawing into focus both the rigor and the strangeness of this methodological alliance between rationalism and empiricism on the side of materialism and against idealism is the project of my book. And I pursue this project through rereadings of Plato, Descartes, Hume, and Hegel before taking up a 20th century tradition, moving from Bachelard through Althusser to Alain Badiou and Quentin Meillassoux. With respect to contemporary philosophy and Meillassoux's work in particular, my intervention is to emphasize the methodological importance of his work, his way of making philosophical arguments, and the orientation and thought that his method implies, rather than focusing solely upon his ontological or epistemological claims. So the project emerges in part from a reflection upon the fact that, in After Finitude, Meillassoux attempts to revive a certain pre-critical or certain pre-critical problems in modern philosophy through a return to both Descartes and to Hume. The question posed by this effort is, how is it possible to be both a Cartesian and a Humean without adopting Kant's transcendental displacement of the opposition between rationalism and empiricism? From Descartes, right, a rationalist, Meillassoux attempts to revive the distinction between the intelligible and the sensible that Locke will later describe in terms of primary and secondary qualities. And Meillassoux will defend the Cartesian thesis that, quote, those aspects of an object that can be formulated in mathematical terms, its primary qualities, can be meaningfully conceived as properties of the object in itself. It's from After Finitude. Now, this is, of course, at odds with the post-Kantian dispensation of modern philosophy that Meillassoux terms correlationism, which holds that it is impossible to know, quote, the properties of the world in itself subsisting indifferently of our relation to it. So that's his inheritance from Descartes, this notion that through mathematical formalization we can determine the properties of the thing in itself. From Hume, on the other hand, Meillassoux attempts to reassert the problem of induction, or what he calls Hume's problem, as the crux of contemporary thought. Meillassoux's thinking of what he calls the necessity of contingency attempts to revive and ultimately resolve the problem of induction by converting the epistemological deficit it entails, so for Hume, that we can have neither rational nor empirical knowledge of any necessary connection between causes and effects. It's the problem of induction. Meillassoux converts this deficit of knowledge into an item of positive knowledge, namely that we can know rationally that there is no such necessary connection between causes and effects. So according to Meillassoux, through a complex argument that's articulated in chapter 3 of After Finitude, what we can know absolutely is that both facts and laws are necessarily contingent. Meillassoux attempts to consolidate this argument for the necessity of contingency by relying upon a form of mathematical knowledge that he associates after Baudieu with the Cartesian legacy. So in chapter 4 of After Finitude, Meillassoux's task is to defend his argument for absolute contingency against objections based upon probabilistic reasoning. He argues that, this argument from probabilistic reasoning is that if the laws of nature were contingent, it's highly improbable that they would not undergo frequent alterations, which evidently they don't. So he attempts to refute this probabilistic argument through recourse to Cantor's theory of transfinite numbers and to Russell's paradox, which prohibit the closure of a set of all possible cases, which, according to Meillassoux, any probabilistic reasoning about the stability of physical law would have to be based upon. So that's the argument in chapter 4 of After Finitude. And the point for Meillassoux is that, as he puts it, by grafting the Humean thesis of the problem of induction onto that of Cantorian in totality, borrowed from Alain Badiou, Meillassoux attempts to resolve the central problem of empiricism with rationalist tools. And he does so in a manner that rejects or attempts to work through the critical proscription of Kant's transcendental idealism. So the importance of these arguments for me, right, is just that he's taking up this empiricist problem of the problem of induction. He's affirming it as a datum of positive knowledge. And then he's going about defending and addressing it with these rationalist tools borrowed from mathematical set theory and Alain Badiou. So it's this conjunction of empiricism and rationalism in his methodology that interests me. So, but again, my argument today will be that in order to think through the relation of rationalism and empiricism within Meillassoux's philosophy, we also have to think through the precise manner in which After Finitude attempts to intervene in the conflict between materialism and idealism. So the question now is, how do we think the co-implication of the position of After Finitude in relation to the two major oppositions that structure the philosophical field, rationalism versus empiricism and materialism versus idealism? And I hope to show that the best way to approach this question is by thinking through the relation of Meillassoux's what he calls speculative materialism to a certain tradition of dialectical materialism analyzed and practiced by Althusser. So here I also hope to respond to a problem raised by Peter Hallward quite a long time ago now in his review of After Finitude that was written shortly after the English translation of the book was published. Hallward argues that, quote, to the degree that Meillassoux insists on the absolute disjunction of an event from existing situations, he deprives himself of any concretely mediated means of thinking with and after Marx the possible ways of changing such situations. So for Hallward, Meillassoux can have no relation to political determination because he removes, he disjoins the event from existing situations. So I don't aim to answer this charge directly in this paper with reference to Meillassoux's theory of absolute contingency, though I've attempted to do that elsewhere in a reply that I published to Peter's review. Rather, I want to explore a broader sense in which Meillassoux might be considered to think with and after Marx. And so how can we situate Meillassoux after Marx? In fact, I want to demonstrate that After Finitude might feasibly be taken as a contribution to what Althusser calls Marxist philosophy. And I'll try to do that not by positioning Meillassoux directly in relation to Marx, but rather by thinking through the mediation of that relationship by Althusser's engagement in his philosophy course for scientists, 1967, and also in his essay, Lenin and Philosophy, 1968, with Lenin's Materialism and Imperial Criticism. So Lenin's book from back in 1908. Which is a book of sort of Marxist epistemology. For After Finitude not only revisits and recasts Lenin's attack on what he called the correlativist and fideist orientation of post-Kantian philosophy, as Ray Brazier has noted, Meillassoux's book also, no doubt unconsciously, roots its modifications of the polemical itinerary of Lenin's texts through the exigencies of Althusser's theory of dialectical materialism. And it's the manner in which Meillassoux answers the Leninist Althusserian injunction to draw a line of demarcation between idealism and materialism that renders Meillassoux's book an exemplary instance of what Althusser calls rationalist empiricism. That is, it's the manner in which Meillassoux determines the relation between materialism and idealism that allows us to understand what we might think of as a disjunctive synthesis of rationalism and empiricism that his work entails. Okay, so what's meant by this term rationalist empiricism? Althusser deploys the term in a 1966 text, it should say, 1966, the philosophical conjuncture and Marxist theoretical research. So in this essay, Althusser lays out three elements in French philosophy that he takes to be constitutive of the theoretical conjuncture in the mid-60s, the situation of French philosophy in the middle of the 60s. So these three elements. So first, what he calls a religious spiritualist element with its origins in the Middle Ages and that persists most powerfully in the form of Bergsonism. Second, what he identifies as a rationalist idealist element that derives, he says, from aspects of Cartesian philosophy and is developed by the critical idealism of Kant and Husserl. And Althusser considers this to be the dominant strand in French philosophy in the 1960s. And then third element, what he calls a rationalist empiricism, a term that Althusser only uses once in this essay. And so here's Althusser's description of this last element that's legible, but I'll read the quotation. So key quotation from Althusser. He says, alongside these two elements, the first two, religious spiritualist and rationalist idealism, a rationalist idealist, there subsists another element, another theoretical layer whose origins may be traced back to the 18th century, rationalist empiricism, and then he says, in its two forms. So first of all, idealist and materialist, right? So these two different forms of rationalist empiricism. He says, materialist rationalist empiricism, right, lives on in the ideology of certain scientific practices, what he calls psychophysiology, etc. We'll come back to that. And then he says, idealist rationalist empiricism does too, lives on in certain scientific practices, and has produced the more interesting results. It was this current which, setting out from other materialist aspects of Descartes' work, spawned the great work of the Encyclopédie, d'Alembert, Diderot, and so on. This tradition was taken up by the only great French philosopher of the 19th century, Auguste Comte, and it saved the honor of French philosophy, Althusser says, during a terrible spiritualist reaction of the 19th century. It has given us the only philosophical tradition that we can trace almost uninterruptedly from the 17th century down to our own day, the tradition of the philosophy of sciences, to which we owe such great names as Comte, Cournot, Couturat, Duhem, and closer to our own time, Cavaillés, Bachelard, Coiret, and Canguilhem. And that's the tradition in which Althusser would situate his own work. So note that there are two traditions included then under the umbrella of rationalist empiricism for Althusser. So first, materialist rationalist empiricism, and second, idealist rationalist empiricism. The first of these, which Althusser links to the ideology of scientific practices like psychophysiology, would seem to be a reductionist materialism, so what we might call today a limitivist materialism, referring perhaps to neurology and cognitive science rather than what Althusser calls psychophysiology. And so Althusser, curiously, right, he doesn't like this tradition, materialist rationalist empiricism, and he situates himself on the other side. He says, it's the second form, Althusser feels, idealist rationalist empiricism, which he says has produced the more interesting results. So curiously, Althusser aligns himself here with an idealist tradition. We'll see how this works. So this is the current running from D'Alembert and Diderot up through Comte to Cavaillés, Bachelard, Coiret, and Canguilhem, which for Althusser has saved the honor of French philosophy. And this is no doubt the tradition in which Althusser's own work on the philosophy of the sciences would be situated. It's also the tradition in which one would have to situate the work of both Badiou and Meillassoux. The problem, however, is that we know that for Althusser, at least by the time of his 1967-1968 lecture course for scientists, the partisan role, what he considers the partisan role of the Marxist philosopher, is to intervene in the philosophy of science on behalf of materialism and against idealism, not on behalf of idealist rationalist empiricism. So what's going on with this strange inconsistency? If this passage thus productively complicates the schema of the later lecture course, it would seem that the task of the Marxist philosopher would not be to intervene on the side simply of materialist rationalist empiricism, considered by Althusser as a reductive scientism, nor exactly, we might say, on behalf of idealist rationalist empiricism, but rather to transform the resources of this latter tradition into a non-reductive materialist orientation. So this is the problem. That is, how to transform the tradition that has saved the honor of French philosophy into a dialectical materialist rationalist empiricism, right? So we have to conjoin all three of these terms. So we don't want the reductive number one, but we don't quite want number two either. Can we get a version which is a dialectical materialism, conjoining rationalism and empiricism? That's the problem of this paper. Now, it's crucial, given the dialectical character of this materialism, that it can't itself result from a mere inversion of idealist rationalist empiricism. And it can't just become materialist rationalist empiricism. Rather, it would have to be produced through a transformation within it. And the model for this sort of transformation is provided by Althusser himself in his great essay, Contradiction and Overdetermination. Through his treatment of Marx's inversion of Hegel, that is, Marx's effort to set Hegel on his feet. And what's at issue in that essay is Marx's remark about extracting the rational kernel from the mystical shell of Hegel's thought. And the question is whether we can simply extract the rational method of dialectical materialism from Hegel's mystical teleology of absolute idealism. And Althusser's theory of structural causality emerges in part from his recognition that we can't simply do so through an inversion. Right, but rather, such an extraction would have to, in fact, involve a real transformation of the dialectic itself. So the dialectic has to be transformed. It can't just be that we invert idealism into materialism. On this model, then, it would be necessary to perform not an inversion, but what Althusser calls a real transformation of idealist rationalist empiricism through a modification of its constitutive elements. What's notable in this regard is Althusser's curious remark, right, that this idealist orientation of rationalist empiricism sets out from, he says, materialist aspects of Descartes' work. So it seems to be a sort of paradox that we draw this idealism from these materialist elements in Descartes. So what's going on here? My argument is that this is precisely, the project would be to recover and reactivate these Cartesian materialist aspects within idealist rationalist empiricism so as to transform it from within into a properly dialectical form of materialism. My argument is that this is actually precisely the task carried out in After Finitude through Meillassoux's effort against the conjunctural dominance of critical idealism or correlationism to recover and reactivate Descartes' claims for the capacity of mathematical physics to index primary qualities, the primary qualities of the in itself. But without, however, Descartes' recourse, religious spiritualist recourse to God as a guarantor of human reason. So this is what Meillassoux attempts through his speculative precipitation of a formally metaphysical problem. The question then is how can what Meillassoux terms his speculative materialism also be understood as a form of dialectical materialism? So the claim here is that Meillassoux is exactly going back to Descartes and extracting these materialist elements without their religious spiritualist sort of thinking within Descartes' entire project. So Althusser offers his most detailed and direct definition of what he thinks of as dialectical materialism in his 1965 text, Theory, Theoretical Practice, and Theoretical Formation, Ideology and Ideological Struggles. So this is written at around the same time as the text with a reference to rationalist empiricism. So here is how Althusser defines dialectical materialism, and for me, this has become a very important passage, kind of key passage in this whole book project, maybe. So he says, in dialectical materialism, it can very schematically be said that it is materialism which represents the aspect of theory, and dialectic which represents the aspect of method. But each of these terms includes the other. Materialism expresses the effective conditions of the practice that produces knowledge. Specifically, first, the distinction between the real and its knowledge. Okay. Distinction of reality, correlative of a correspondence or adequacy between knowledge and its object. correspondence of knowledge, right? So on the one hand, we want to distinguish between the real and our knowledge of the real, and on the other hand, we want our knowledge of the real to be adequate to the real. And second, he says, the primacy of the real over its knowledge, or the primacy of being over thought. So these are the crucial elements of materialism. He says, nonetheless, these principles themselves are not eternal principles, but the principles of the historical nature of the process in which knowledge is produced. That is why materialism is called dialectical. Dialectics, which expresses the relation that theory maintains with its object, expresses this relation not as a relation of two simply distinct terms, but as a relation within a process of transformation, thus of real production. So here stressing the historical dimension of this relation between knowledge and the real. So, okay, there are two primary components here. On the one hand, a definition of materialism, and on the other, a definition of dialectics. And though I do not mean to forward an argument concerning influence or intention, I would hold that the philosophical itinerary, the structural articulation, and the argumentative method of afterfinitude adhere very closely to the determination of dialectical materialism spelled out here by Althusser. That is to say, Meillassoux attempts to meet these conditions. Or better, that Meillassoux's text unfolds the requirements of the co-determinations that are constitutive of this form of dialectical materialism. So to break this down then, Althusser's definition of materialism itself includes two criteria, and the first of which is also internally articulated. So these are the key criteria of a materialist position for Althusser. So 1A, again, to recapitulate, distinction between the real and its knowledge. We could call this criterion of distinction. 1B, correspondence between knowledge and its object, what we could call criterion of adequacy. And then 2, right, those are both within the first one, 2, primacy of the real over its knowledge, or the primacy of being over thought, the criterion of primacy. Right, that we can't situate thought before being. Right? We can't situate thought before the real. We have to move from the real into thought. Note that the first of Althusser's materialist criteria, itself double, does not really challenge Kant's program of transcendental idealism. Okay, so the distinction between the real and its knowledge is accounted for in Kant by the distinction between noumena and phenomena. And on the other hand, the correspondence between knowledge and its object is accounted for by the synthesis of the manifold by the forms of intuition and the categories of the understanding. That is to say, thought is adequate to its object because of the determination of objects by the categories of the understanding and the forms of intuition. It's this determination of the object by the forms of thought that, for Kant, ensures the transcendental grounding of reliable scientific knowledge of phenomena. Objects correspond to thought because objects are determined by the forms of thought. According to Meillassoux, however, and also according to Lenin and to Althusser, no correlationist or critical idealist philosophy can properly meet Althusser's second criterion, the primacy of the real over its knowledge, or the primacy of being over thought. Right? So this is the problem then. What does Althusser mean by primacy? He might be taken to refer to a broadly Marxist foregrounding of the primacy of practice, or to the structure of social relations in and through which knowledge is produced. But maybe more fundamentally, the primacy of the real over its knowledge, or the primacy of being over thought, refers us to a passage in the Grundrisse, in Marx's Grundrisse, a passage that's often cited by Althusser, in which Marx states that the real, what Althusser calls the concrete real, or the real object, so this is from Marx, the real survives in its independence, after as before, outside the head. So Marx's little formulation from the introduction to the Grundrisse. Right? The real survives in its independence after as before, outside the head. That is, this passage refers us to the chronological primacy of the real, after as before, right? The anteriority and the ulteriority of its exteriority to thought, right? Both after and before, the real is exterior to thought. In Meillassoux's terms, it refers to what Meillassoux calls the temporal discrepancy of thinking and being, or the diachronicity of being and thought. Meillassoux's strategy is thus to begin with this crux in chapter one of After Finitude. And so here, you know, you might take a look at this graph. So the five chapters of the book are laid out sequentially in the graph. And then what I've done is, nevertheless, the book doesn't really work in order. That is to say, the problem that the book tries to solve comes from chapter five to chapter three, right? And chapter three is the key chapter where he makes his real argument. And then chapter one tries to motivate the argument of chapter three. And chapter two also tries to motivate the argument of chapter three. And then chapter four tries to defend the argument of chapter three. And then from chapter four, that defense, we get a philosophical problem that stretches beyond the itinerary of Meillassoux's book. So this, you don't have to read the whole thing, but anyway, this maps out this more sort of complex topology of Meillassoux's book, which really, you read it in order, but then you have to reconstruct what I call its order of reasons, which is a term borrowed from Marcel Garou in his book on Descartes, great two-volume book on Descartes' Meditations, Descartes According to the Order of Reasons. Okay, so Meillassoux's strategy is thus to begin with this crux of diachronicity, the temporal discrepancy of thinking and being in chapter one of After Finitude, by showing how the problem of ancestrality exposes the impossibility of properly affirming the primacy of being over thought within the framework of correlationism. That is, in chapter one, the problem is how to properly affirm the chronological anteriority of being over the logical anteriority of the act of thinking, right? So how do we demonstrate within thought, right, that the object of thought comes before thought, right, and not impose thought, the anteriority of thought, it's coming before onto the object. How do we hold the object before thought, but within thought, right? It's the problem of what he calls the problem of ancestrality, or the arche fossil, at the beginning of the book. So the heuristic of the arche fossil, that is kind of lesson, it's just a lesson, it's not a demonstration, is intended to show that, quote, is intended to show the logical retrojection of the past on the basis of the present that's performed by the correlationist, right, by which the act of thought, or in Kant, the transcendental conditions of understanding, is posited as logically prior to that which is thought, right? So in Kant, we have the transcendental conditions of the determination of any object, and those are logically prior, right, to the determination of the object, to any knowledge of the object. Meillassoux wants to show that this sort of setup undermines our capacity to properly grasp the chronological primacy of the real over its knowledge, right? Criterion two. Or to accede to what he calls the diachronicity of being and thinking. So the difficulty for the materialist then becomes how to meet the ontological criterion of primacy, right? The real comes before knowledge of the real, while also meeting the double epistemological criteria of distinction and adequacy, so the first two. So how do we begin with number two and then hold on to A and B? Doing this involves moving from the heuristic, or the kind of introductory lesson of the arche fossil, to an actual refutation of the correlationist, who either rejects the order of primacy, in the case of absolute idealism, Hegel, or covertly undermines its proper sense, in the case of transcendental idealism or Kant. And the crucial point here is to acknowledge that the problem of ancestrality is not itself intended to produce a refutation of critical or absolute idealism. It's only intended to motivate such a refutation by producing a line of demarcation, a distinction between materialist and idealism. The method by which Meillassoux performs this actual refutation over the course of chapters 2 and 3 is dialectical in precisely the sense articulated by Althusser. So when Meillassoux gets around to actually trying to refute Hegel and Kant, basically, also Heidegger, the figure of the correlationist, how does he do it? Right? And I claim that it's dialectical in Althusser's sense, that it has an importantly, a crucially historical dimension. So first of all, how does he do this? First, he accounts for what Althusser calls the historical nature of the process in which knowledge is produced. by diagnosing the complicity of what he calls fideism with correlationism and with the postmodern return of the religious. So this is the object of critique in the second chapter of Meillassoux's book. Here he establishes the most pertinent historical condition of his philosophical practice through an analysis of what Althusser would call a theoretical ideological conjuncture. So, Meillassoux says that contemporary fideism, this return to the religious, or this return to the primacy of faith over knowledge, which he sort of diagnoses, is the theoretical conjuncture in which he's working, right? It's a historical determination of his thought and of contemporary philosophy. So this is a conjuncture, for example, in which so-called constructivist epistemologies of science are deployed by the religious right against the scientific evidence of global warming, for example, or in favor of creationist so-called alternatives to Darwin's theory of evolution, right? So this kind of fideism in which religious ideological arguments are marshaled against the evidence of science. It's what he refers to as fideism. And he says that, right, correlationism, the sort of epistemological relativism of thinking the object is always determined as a correlate of thought, is one of the reasons for this reemergence of fideism. That's the argument of chapter two. So Meillassoux takes up his philosophy's relation to this conjuncture as, quote, as what Althusser would call a process of transformation, by working within the positions of his opponents. His opponents being the dogmatist, the correlationist, and the subjective idealist. The argument gauges the implications of these other positions for one another until it locates the weakest link in the system of their relationships, what Meillassoux calls the problem of the facticity of the correlation itself, and then it demarcates the stake that's inherent in this problem. So here's the argument. The correlationist will have to uphold the facticity of the correlation itself against the subjective idealist absolutization of the correlation. So what does that mean? It means that Kant wants to say, right, the forms of knowledge that are transcendental to the determination of the object are just a fact. We can't say whether they're necessary or contingent. I can't claim that they have like a necessary status in the way that they determine objects. Hegel, on the other hand, right, will have done with this, and he'll identify thinking and being directly. Right? That is to say, he'll violate 1a, the distinction of the real from its knowledge. And when he does so, he does what Meillassoux calls absolutizes the correlation. Right? He says the forms of thought are a necessary determination of objects. Right? Meillassoux doesn't want to do either of these things. Right? So he doesn't want to affirm the facticity of the correlation to say that it's just a fact like any other, or at least that's what he shows that Kant has to do to maintain his position against Hegel. Right? So if you're a Kantian, you have to say, no, the forms of thought are not absolute or necessary determinations of the real. They're just a fact, and we can't say whether or not they're necessary or contingent. And Meillassoux wants to show the double bind into which this places the Kantian philosopher. So Meillassoux attempts to show that the correlationist, let's say the Kantian philosopher, or the Heideggerian philosopher, the Derridean philosopher, will have to covertly affirm the necessity of contingency itself. He doesn't want to, but he'll have to do it anyway, despite himself, in order to refute Hegel. That is to say, he'll have to affirm the absolute possibility that the correlation, that the forms of thought, the forms of the determination of the object, could be otherwise. He has to affirm against Hegel that they absolutely could be otherwise, right? The consequences that follow from this argument, first and foremost what Meillassoux will call the principle of factiality in the translation, that to be is necessarily to be a fact, or that everything that is necessarily contingent, are then consequences that are inherent to this co-determination of other philosophical positions, constitutive of the conjuncture. So this is the key point for me. That is to say, he draws his conclusion from an assessment of the relational field of philosophical forces, as Althusser would put it. Right. That is to say, he considers, what do you have to say if you're a Kantian or a correlationist after Hegel, right? And then by forcing that the necessity of that saying, then he draws his position from that field of forces. So what's important for him is this competition of other philosophical positions among themselves. That is to say, their historical development in relation to one another. Meillassoux establishes what he calls an anhypothetical principle. Very interesting term in Meillassoux. One that is not deduced from some prior proposition, but one that is rather proved by argument, right? And it's proved by argument in the following way, by demonstrating that anyone who can test the position can only do so by presupposing it to be true, and thereby refuting himself. The import of this indirect method of demonstration is that it does not simply posit philosophical principles in an axiomatic fashion and then draw consequences from them. On this point, Meillassoux deviates markedly from the methodology of his mentor, Alain Badiou. Badiou posits axioms and draws consequences. Meillassoux doesn't want to do that. Meillassoux's effort is to establish his position anhypothetically by indirect argumentation, by working through the intrasystemic consequences of his opponent's logic and the relations between their positions. And this marks an acknowledgement that any and all philosophical hypotheses are already immersed in the conjunctural field within which one establishes one's own position. Indeed, it would be difficult to find a more exact demonstration of philosophical practice, as it is defined by Althusser, than the demonstration of the principle of factiality in chapter 3 of After Finitude. That is to say, for Althusser, philosophical practice consists in intervening in the field of philosophical positions and drawing lines of demarcation between them in order to transform their relationship. Okay, so my claim is this is dialectical in Althusser's sense. We then return in the final two chapters of After Finitude to the materialist upshot of this dialectical procedure. Having demarcated one's philosophy from dogmatic metaphysics, absolute idealism, and transcendental idealism by thinking through the relation between their positions, how is it then possible to affirm on the side of materialism both the distinction of the real from knowledge and the adequacy of knowledge to its object, while properly recognizing the primacy of the real over its knowledge or of being over thought? So the answer offered at the end of After Finitude is that we can do so only by reestablishing the absolute scope of mathematical discourse that's proper to what he calls a decentering of thought relative to the world within the process of knowledge. Decentering of thought relative to the world within the process of knowledge. And this Meillassoux takes to have been constitutive of the Copernican revolution and to its Galilean and Cartesian development. He says, what is mathematizable cannot be reduced to a correlate of thought. This formulates the condition for the distinction between the real and its knowledge. Mathematical physics manifests thought's capacity to think what there is, whether thought exists or not, right? So distinction of the real from knowledge. It exists whether thought exists or not. This formulates the condition for the correspondence also between knowledge and its object, the adequacy of the object of knowledge to the real object. In other words, the mathematization of experimental science enables the adequation of thought to the distinction of the real, right? It fulfills those first two conditions. And most pertinently for the materialist criteria outlined by Althusser, it's the mathematical formalization of empirical science that answers the question at the root of what he calls the paradox of manifestation, which I think we might take to be the fundamental question of any rationalist empiricism. And the paradox of manifestation is, how is empirical knowledge of the world anterior to or before, how is empirical knowledge of a world anterior to all experience possible? Right. So how do we have an empirical knowledge of a world that comes before any experience? For Meillassoux, it is mathematical physics that enables us to adequately think what there was before thought, to think the adequation of thought to the distinction of a real which is prior to thought, fulfills all three conditions. So that's a reading of After Finitude through Meillassoux's definition of dialectical materialism. So this then, to come back to Descartes, is the materialist aspect of Descartes' work that we might hope to locate at the root of a tradition of what Althusser had called idealist rationalist empiricism, and which might be mobilized toward a materialist transformation of that tradition. It's this capacity, holds Meillassoux, whereby mathematized science is able to deploy a world which is separable from man, that Descartes theorized in all its power. Thus, when Meillassoux claims allegiance to what he calls an in itself that is Cartesian and no longer Kantian, in itself grasped by mathematical formalism, he does so in the name of the materialist criteria outlined by Althusser. And also, when Meillassoux arrives at this affirmation through a conjunctural assessment of the consequences of relations between other discrepant philosophical positions, he does so according to Althusser's criteria for dialectical thought. It's on these grounds that I would argue that when Meillassoux elaborates his own criteria of properly speculative materialism, he also elaborates the criteria of what we could call, adjusting Althusser, a dialectical materialist rationalist empiricism, right? So this is what we want. So here's Meillassoux. He says, every materialism that would be speculative and hence for which absolute reality is an entity without thought must assert both that thought is not necessary, something can be independently of thought, and that thought can think what there must be when there is no thought, right? So that's the problem. The materialism that chooses to follow the speculative path is thereby constrained to believe that it is possible to think a given reality by abstracting from the fact that we are thinking it. Now, in his lecture course for scientists, and in Lenin and philosophy, Althusser positions the defense of such a materialism as a vocation of Marxist philosophy. And he says that this is the task of Marxist philosophy, or of thinking with and after Marx. So I want to turn then to the mediated relation of Meillassoux's work to Lenin's philosophical project in materialism and imperial criticism. And it's this, you know, work of Lenin's that runs through Althusser's engagement with these epistemological problems in the 1960s. So briefly, to go then to Althusser's lecture course for scientists, so now we're up to 1967, right before the events of the French May in 1968. So Althusser says, there are two spontaneous philosophies of the scientists at work in scientific practice. So SPS, spontaneous philosophy of the scientists, right? Yeah. So he says the first one, right, there are two of these, two spontaneous philosophies of the scientists. So the first one is a materialist belief that's internal to science and its origin in what he calls the real, external, and material existence of the object of scientific knowledge, right? And in the existence and objectivity of scientific knowledges that permit knowledge of this object, right? So that's the materialist, spontaneous philosophy of the scientist. And then there's a second position, which is extra scientific in its origin, outside of science, a reflection upon scientific practice by spiritualist or critical idealist philosophies of science that operate by calling into question the external material existence of the object, that are then replaced by experience or experiment, and by calling into question the objectivity of scientific knowledge and of scientific theory that are replaced by models. And so this would be the idealist position for Althusser. So according to Althusser, this first position, or materialism, is massively dominated by the second position, or an idealist philosophy of science, which is post-Kantian in its orientation. And he says, these post-Kantian positions exploit scientific knowledge in order to insist upon the primacy of philosophy. In his relation to the sciences, then, the task of the Marxist philosopher, the practitioner of what Althusser thinks of as dialectical materialism, is to intervene on the side of SPS 1, right? Of this materialist spontaneous philosophy. And in Lenin and Philosophy, so last long quote from Althusser, Althusser formulates this obligation as follows. So this is the obligation of the Marxist philosopher in relation to science. He says, materialist philosophy is particularly concerned with what happens in scientific practice, but in a manner peculiar to itself because it represents in its materialist thesis the spontaneous convictions of the scientists about the existence of the objects of their sciences and the objectivity of their knowledge. Right? So scientists already think, right, that the objects that they're studying are real outside of thought and that they can have adequate knowledge of them. So we have to help the scientists in their spontaneous materialism, right? In materialism and imperial criticism, Lenin constantly repeats the statement that most specialists in the sciences of nature are spontaneously materialistic. This is still Althusser, at least in one of the tendencies of their spontaneous philosophy. So while fighting the ideologies of the spontaneism of scientific practice, like empiricism or pragmatism, Lenin recognizes in the experience of scientific practice a spontaneous materialist tendency of the highest importance for Marxist philosophy. He thus interrelates the materialist theses required to think the specificity of scientific knowledge with the spontaneous materialist tendency of the practitioners of the sciences, as expressing both practically and theoretically one and the same materialist thesis of existence and objectivity. So Lenin already in 1908 wants to defend this spontaneous materialism of the sciences against the sort of predations of idealist philosophy. In the terminology that we've developed, we can say that Lenin's project is emblematic for Althusser of what would be the Marxist vocation of dialectical materialist rationalist empiricism. Right? To recapitulate the Althusserian schema, Marxist science, right, Marx's own science, historical materialism, so it is a science, intervenes through an analysis of political economy, one that tells us why it is the masses and not generic men or philosophers or scientists. It's the masses who make their own history, though not under conditions of their own choosing. Marxist philosophy intervenes on the behalf of the materialist tendency of the sciences and therefore of Marxist science. According to this model, the relation of Marxist philosophy to politics is thus not direct. Right? It's mediated by the relation of Marxist philosophy to political economy, or Marxist science, the critique of political economy. So thus, I might say, insofar as one expects a direct relation between philosophy and politics, one will underestimate the importance of the critique of political economy in mediating the relation between philosophy and politics. Okay. Last section on the relation of Meillassoux and Lenin. So it's through their discrepant approaches to the results and operations of science that I think we have to think the complex relation of afterfinitude to Lenin's practice of Marxist philosophy in his early work. Meillassoux's project is closest to Lenin's in its unabashed defense of the literalism of scientific statements. Right, so Lenin's target in the section of materialism and imperial criticism titled Did Nature Exist Prior to Man, right, is precisely that of Meillassoux's chapter on the problem of ancestrality. It's the problem of how we can intelligibly claim, extend a chain of experience of possible objects of perception through a time series prior to the evolution of perception itself. This so-called idealist sophistry is glossed by Lenin as follows. So this is already in Lenin, 1908, right? This is a very interesting text. He says, only if I make the admission that man could be the observer of an epoch at which he did not exist, one absurd and contradictory to natural science, can I make the ends of my philosophy meet, right? So if we say we have to rely upon the existence of thought in order to have objects of thought, right, in order to think them as objects of knowledge, then we would have to sort of like extend the hypothetical existence of man before the existence of man, of perception before the existence of perception. Like Lenin, whose goal in this early text was to, quote, liberate the realm of objects from the yoke of the subject, right, is what Lenin says. Meillassoux seeks to defend the realist sense of scientific statements against the ideology of critical idealism. It's thus the literal meaning of science's ancestral statements that the first chapter of Afterfinitude defends against their inversion by the correlationist, against the for us that performs a sort of retrojection of the past from the present upon any statement concerning that which occurred before us, right? So Meillassoux says this for us, which Meillassoux calls the codicil of modernity, against this codicil of modernity. So object X existed at such and such a time before us, but for us, right? So that we retroject this for us onto the previous existence of the object. So against this codicil of modernity, when we say event X occurred prior to the emergence of thought for thought, both Lenin and Meillassoux hold that this codicil of modernity is irrelevant when it comes to analyzing the significance of scientific statements about the temporal existence of objects before perception. Unlike Lenin, however, so here's the difference between the two, Meillassoux does not endorse the literal sense of scientific statements as, quote, a direct connection of the mind with the external world. That's what Lenin says. But rather, He defends the literal sense of scientific statements as a discourse enabled by mathematical formalization. So Meillassoux accepts Bachelard's dictate in the philosophy of no, that the world in which we think is not the world in which we live. Very important statement in Bachelard. The world in which we think is not the world in which we live. And this is the point of mathematical physics, right? To know a world in which that is separated from the givens of everyday perception. Thus, Meillassoux endorses the literal sense of scientific statements as scientific statements, as mediated by mathematical physics. He does so on the condition that we attend to the fact that their literal meaning carries far more powerful counterintuitions, or strangeness, than the banal retrojection performed by the codicil of modernity. This is why Meillassoux insists, unlike Lenin, quote, that we remain as distant from naive realism as from correlationist subtlety, which are two ways of refusing to see ancestrality as a problem. And he says, what has become a famous formulation, the virtue of transcendentalism does not lie in rendering realism illusory, but in rendering it astonishing, apparently unthinkable, yet true. And this is why, he says, what distinguishes the philosopher from the non-philosopher is that only the former, the philosopher, is capable of being astonished in the strong sense by the straightforwardly literal meaning of the ancestral statement. That is to say, it's astonishing that we really can say that object X occurred at such and such a time before the existence of thought or our knowledge of that object. What Lenin ignores is that it's this paradox, the paradoxical dimension of the problem of manifestation, that renders the literal sense of ancestral statements profound. The problem is not to elide this profundity, but rather to think it in a manner that adequately traverses the relation of transcendental philosophy to realism without collapsing into correlationism. And this is why it's crucial to recognize that the problem of ancestrality is by no means intended to refute Kant's transcendental idealism. It merely functions as a sort of preparation for the ground of the intra-systemic critique of Kant that's performed in the book's third chapter. As is probably obvious, the other major difference between the program of Meillassoux and that of Lenin is that Lenin has very little to say, right? He's not concerned with the sort of ontological arguments forwarded by Meillassoux concerning absolute contingency that's inherent to an absolute time. So how are we to consider this relation of Meillassoux's arguments to his defense of scientific materialism? Let's say, if we align his defense of scientific materialism with Lenin and with Althusser, what about this dimension of his thought which insists on the absolute contingency of physical law? How is that consistent with the defense of science? If we are to take this problem seriously, we have to consider it methodologically, through Meillassoux's dialectical practice of philosophy. The problem of absolute contingency follows from the logical consequences of the absolutization of facticity arrived at in the third chapter of After Finitude, which itself follows from an indirect demonstration based upon these other competing positions. If we follow Meillassoux's argumentative itinerary, absolute contingency, the total contingency of any physical law, that it can change, right, emerges as the only absolute which it is possible to salvage from correlationism without absolutizing the correlation itself in the manner of Hegel. That is, without affirming speculative idealism rather than speculative materialism. It's therefore the only means of refuting the Kantian philosopher's limitation of reason in order to make room for faith. But without equating reason with absolute spirit. So in order to sustain the contingency of the correlation itself, the Kantian philosopher must covertly think contingency itself as an absolute. That's the argument. The rationalist delineation of absolute contingency's structural position within the balance of philosophical forces is not, then, some dogmatic proposition. Rather, it follows from the dialectical recognition that the effects of philosophical arguments upon one another are irreversible. It follows from a commitment in Althusserian terms to the fact that there is a history in philosophy rather than a history of philosophy, what he calls the history of the displacement of the indefinite repetition of a null trace whose effects are real. Lovely formulation in Althusser. The principle of factiality of absolute contingency registers a displacement of the null trace that divides materialism and idealism. And what Meillassoux registers as the necessity of thinking absolute contingency inherent to absolute time registers the fact that the displacement of this trace within the history of philosophy has real effects. That is to say, it has to be obeyed, right? The relation of the Kantian to the Hegelian position and how it's possible to defend the contingency of the correlation itself against its subsumption by absolute idealism. This has real effects that one has to obey. That is to say, this displacement and its argumentative effects result from an immersion in the restrictive dialectical exigencies of correctly inscribing a line of demarcation between materialism and idealism, a line that is incorrectly drawn by Lenin due to his concessions to naive realism. So they want to make the same argument, but Lenin does it in a naive realist way and Meillassoux in a more sophisticated way. Okay, so paradoxically then, Meillassoux's defense of scientific materialism in here is exactly where we might least expect to find it, in his rejection of the principle of uniformity of nature. That is to say, in his affirmation that the laws of nature are contingent, right? This is crucial to his very defense of scientific materialism against idealism. And in this, I'll sort of shorten this section, but this also aligns him even with a sort of a more conservative philosopher of science like Karl Popper. Right, so Karl Popper recognizes that we don't have to affirm the necessity of physical laws. We don't know whether physical laws are necessary or not, right? Popper admits that that's just a kind of methodological assumption of scientific practice, but that we can't prove it ontologically. But crucially, the problem with that is that it opens up, it sort of subordinates knowledge to faith, right? Then we simply have to have faith, or right, we have to suppose that without knowing exactly why the laws of nature are necessary. And so Meillassoux tries to confirm this datum of faith or supposition, right, a sort of dogmatic assumption of the scientist, into a rational object of knowledge. On the contrary, we can know for sure that the physical laws of nature are contingent. And this, in fact, doesn't interfere with the operations of science, because science doesn't need to know that they're necessary. It just needs to practice. It needs to go through the laws of its own practice. So philosophy aids the operations of science by defending it against what Althusser and Bachelard call epistemological obstacles, against its subtle exploitation by idealism, and against the interference of religion. There's no contradiction, then, but a relation of positive reinforcement between Meillassoux's defense of absolute contingency and the fundamental role that Althusser accords to dialectical materialism. That is, the defense of the materialist tendency of scientific practice against its domination by idealism and spiritualism. But this defense is certainly more complex, more counterintuitive, and more compelling in after finitude than in Lenin's materialism and imperial criticism. Lenin holds that there is no inherent incompatibility between the outer world and our sense perceptions of it. Right? He says the perceptions give us correct impressions of things by which we directly know objects themselves. Meillassoux, on the other hand, affirms not the immediate evidence of the senses, but the evidence of science, allowing for discrepancies between scientific knowledge and our manifest experience of the world in everyday life. And he asserts that it is mathematical physics which provides us with the knowledge of the real that Lenin accords to the senses. So Lenin's goal is the same as Meillassoux's, to defend the distinction of reality and what Althusser calls the correspondence of knowledge, while also rigorously maintaining the primacy of being over thought. But while Lenin fails to grasp the formidable difficulties that those criteria impose upon anyone who would meet them after Kant, it's a more careful assessment of those difficulties to which the counterintuitions of after finitude attest, that is to say, the strangeness of its ontological arguments. So to conclude then, this final passage from Althusser. It's on these grounds that I would finally align after finitude with Althusser's philosophical dream, he says, of a text that would complete and correct the program of Marxist philosophy undertaken by Lenin. Althusser says, if it is true, as so many signs indicate, that today the lag of Marxist philosophy can in part be overcome, doing so will not only cast light on the past, but also perhaps transform the future. In this transformed future, justice will be done equitably to all those who had to live in the contradiction of philosophical urgency and political urgency and philosophical lag. Right? So he says, philosophy always lags behind politics, right? And this is a problem, but something that we have to accept. Justice will be done to one of the greatest, to Lenin. Right? Justice, his philosophical work will then be perfected. Perfected, that is to say, completed and corrected. We surely owe this service and this homage to the man who was lucky enough to be born in time for politics, but unfortunate enough to be born too early for philosophy. After all, who chooses his own birth date? Of course, Althusser acknowledges that this is just a dream. But regardless of his own criterion for that judgment, I would posit that it is just a dream because there will never be a time at which we do not live in the contradiction of political urgency and philosophical lag. Philosophy will always lag behind politics. But within the lag that is philosophy, we can say that After Finitude does indeed render justice to Lenin's philosophical work. In doing so, it also renders justice to a phantom lineage that was the latent content of another Althusserian dream, the lineage of dialectical materialist rationalist empiricism. Thanks.